Hello, this is Bishop William Murphy, and I'm here to share with you some news. Our Holy Father, Pope Francis, for some time has been speaking about marriage and family, and he's talked about all the various kinds of situations in which people find themselves in their marriages and in their families in every part of the world. One of those is the fact that in our society, particularly in our Western society today, marriages fail. One out of two marriages in some cases, in most cases, almost 50% of marriages in the United States end up in divorce. What happens when two Catholics marry and they have a sacramental marriage, and for reasons that no one ever foresaw, that marriage falls apart? The Pope is very, very sensitive to the suffering that goes on in the lives of a husband and a wife as their marriage starts to break away. And he also understands with a pastor's heart what life is like after they've had to split and have a divorce, and what their lives as Catholics can be affected, and affected so deeply by that whole experience. Because he knows that our God is a Father, the Father of mercies. Because he knows that Jesus Christ shares with us not just the beauty of life in this world, but also the sorrows and the struggles of life in this world. He wishes, as the Father of the Universal Church, to reach out and to offer help to those men and women whose marriages, sacramentally celebrated, may have fallen apart, and they desire to have what's called the declaration of nullity, to bring a conclusion in their own lives to that particular chapter of their lives and to regain a serenity of soul. So what did the Pope do? He promised for some time, and a year ago he actually put together a small group of people, experts in the field of canon law, to take a look at the canon law, the church law on the tribunals. Those are the courts that are set up in every diocese to handle cases of marriages that may have fallen apart and may not be able to be continued, but may also be able to be dissolved with a declaration of nullity that says that there was some defect that made it impossible for this sacramental marriage to fructify and bear fruit and become a true sacrament. And so he wrote what's called a motu proprio. Now that just means by my own initiative. And he wrote one for the church, the Latin church, the Western church, if you will, the church of most of us Catholics here in Long Island. And another one very similar to it for the churches of the Eastern Rites. Those are the ancient churches of the Middle East, many of whose adherents live here with us and are good Catholics, just the same as we Latin Catholics are. And we each have our own traditions of church law. So he wrote one of motu proprio by his own initiative for the church in the West and a similar one for the church in the East. I'd like to explain what he said to us in this recent motu proprio so that you'll understand from your bishop just what the Pope is saying and just what he's not saying. And I'm just a few points, I think I can do this. The first is, what is the intention of the Holy Father? His desire, his commitment, his goal is to streamline the work of our tribunals in handling cases of couples who married in the church but are separated and divorced, and to have that marriage declared null. He wants to simplify the process without in any way, and these are his words, lessening the importance of the sacrament of marriage. How does he do it? In the opening of this motu proprio, he puts together two principles. And these two principles have to be kept in mind at all times. Two times, the Pope stresses that the Church teaches and ever more deeply seeks to teach that sacramental marriage is indissoluble. Indissoluble. And that's the first principle. He makes it very clear. The Church has taught and has maintained that marriage is a sacrament, and as such it cannot be dissolved by any human being. He then adds a second principle. The second principle that goes with indissolubility is that Latin principle, salus animarum suprema lex. The salvation of souls is the supreme law for the church. That's why we're here. We're here to be instruments of Christ's love for his church to save human beings. And so those two principles go together. One cannot be separated from the other, and neither one is contrary to the other. The committee who prepared these rules, these new simplified rules, were very much aware of that twofold principle, indissolubility and the salvation of souls is the supreme law for the life of the church. And so they remained unyielding, as the Pope is, to the principle of indissolubility, but they're seeking to offer to couples in these situations God's mercy, which is consistent with the principle of the salvation of souls. Now, the Holy Father makes a number of changes, and I'm not going to do that canon by canon. Let the specialists do that, okay? What I'm going to do is to give you a very true, very authentic, unambiguously authentic and faithful expression of what the Pope says by making 8 quick points. And those are the 8 principal things that our Holy Father Pope Francis wants us to understand. He changes the tribunal process. First, there now can be one sentence, which they call first instance, in favor of nullity, and that is sufficient. Ordinarily in the past, there would be a second review. Ordinarily today, as of December 8th, there is no need for a second instance or a court decision confirming the first decision. And as you can see, this saves time, this reduces work, this makes it the tribunals able to respond much more quickly to the needs of people. The second point, the case can now be heard by one judge alone without two other judges. And that too makes it easier. One judge under the responsibility of the bishop instead of a 3-judge panel. So if I appoint someone to be a judge in this case and say, you as one judge, I trust you, you can do it by yourself. We don't have to have a 3-judge panel anymore. Third, the bishop himself is now able to be a judge in the tribunal. The Holy Father has made all of us diocesan bishops judges. For me to act as a judge, he adds this, however, the evidence must be very clear, and the bishop must be convinced of all of the facts so that when he makes a decision, he can make a serene decision, which is called based on moral certainty of the nullity of the bond. He has to be morally certain that the bond does not exist for some intrinsic reason. So I can be a judge, but I have to accept to do it, and I have to be able to make a serene judgment with moral certitude that the facts are the way I see them to be. Fourthly, as he has revised the canons, and by the way, the word canon is like, that's one of the rules. The code of canon law is a code or a book of the rules of canon law, of church law. The revised canons aim to make the process briefer than it has been in the past, and the Pope speaks very clearly about the importance of doing two things: avoiding any undue delays in order that a decision is not postponed. He doesn't want decisions postponed, so he says, let's make the process as clear and as brief as we possibly can. The fifth, once a decision is made, and one or both of the parties are not pleased with this, and they have some real reasons, they can appeal it. So just as in our civil courts, there's a process of appeal. And the appeal goes to what's called the Metropolitan Tribunal. That may sound strange. It's the tribunal, the court of the Archdiocese of New York in our case. Now, that's set up by the agreement of the 8 dioceses of New York, the Metropolitan Tribunal, and we can make changes in that. The bishops can agree to make Albany the one, or they could make Buffalo the one, or they could make Rockville Center the one. whatever we do, we can set that up, but that's the appeal court. And if there is real reason and some facts that have to be brought forward that have not been, either or both of the parties can make an appeal to what's called the Metropolitan Tribunal. Sixth, the Episcopal Conference. You know, we have a conference of bishops of the whole United States, and they have had certain roles to play in the past. As of December 8th, their roles have changed. Their role now is mainly to help dioceses, and this would be especially small dioceses that don't have as many personnel and as many resources that the Diocese of Rockville Centre has. Their job now is to help dioceses in setting up tribunals that can work this way and guaranteeing that they're going to function for the good of the people who are the petitioners asking for a case to be heard. And in the same time, they have to make sure as an Episcopal conference that the bishop is paying the officials and giving them a just remuneration, while the Pope asks us to see to what extent we can make a commitment to minimize the financial burden on the parties in the process. Now, many of you know, and I want to repeat it, as of September 1st, I have eliminated all tribunal fees except a $100 charge to have your case filed. So in this diocese, we already made that decision. I made it because I thought it was the right thing, but it took me time to be able to work out the budget of the diocese so that I could absorb the costs into our budget. But in the Diocese of Rockville Center, there are no fees beyond the $100 registration fee. Seventh, just as appeal can be made to the Metropolitan Tribunal, so appeal can be made to the Holy See, to the Roman Rota. If either or both of the parties have serious reasons to have recourse to the Apostolic See after a decision of the first instance. And eighth and finally, what the Holy Father has decreed for the churches of the Latin Rite, for us, he's done the same thing, as I mentioned at the beginning, he's done the same thing for the Eastern churches with sensitivity toward their own particular traditions and their own special needs as Catholic churches of the East. What's my conclusion? First of all, a word of gratitude to the Holy Father, because by these two initiatives, motu proprio, my initiative on my own, he has given us a way to simplify the processes and open up the tribunals to people who are seeking a resolution of their situation in a way that I hope will encourage them to make use of the tribunal of our diocese and the tribunals of any and all dioceses where they may be living. And so we also be grateful to the Holy Father for his paternal care, for couples whose marriages have not turned out as they had hoped and dreamed, and who find themselves in a situation in which they wish to seek a declaration of nullity of their marriage so that they might regain the spiritual serenity that the Lord wants us all to have as members of the body of the church. The mercy of God is always consistent with the church's defense of marriage as the basic cell of all society, and as a sacrament, the indissoluble bond of a man and a woman who mirror Christ in their marriage. For remember what the Lord himself has taught us, and St. Paul has made so clear, that the Christ is the bridegroom of his bride, the church, and the love of a husband and a wife mirror the love of Christ and his church. May that be the gift we all have as church and the gift that all married couples have in their lives. But know always that when real situations arise and things cannot be avoided, the church is here with the merciful love of the Father and a constant care for the salvation of souls, which is the supreme law.